Yeah, I'm very honoured to be here to give the Knibbs lecture in the Knibbs Lecture Theatre, which is actually an accident only because of COVID and ANU has shut itself to the rest of the world to have it, that here today. Also, in the offices of my first graduate employer, and I was saying to Anders, I never worked in this building. I did work a long time in the Cameron offices, but in fact, I joined when part of ABS I was in MacArthur House, which seems to have been demolished. So when I was asked to give this talk, I thought, what shall I talk about? And I thought, well, I'm a sample survey person. Somewhat reluctantly, when I left university, I was very well trained in what we now call statistical modelling and data analysis. And I was very happy to get a job with the ABS. And it turned out that they wanted me to work on design, how to get relevant and reliable data in an efficient way. And I felt a bit frustrated about that in the first 2 or 3 years. But over time, I realised that's the most important job of a statistician. There ain't no data. You can't do any analysis. And if the data is rubbish, your analysis is rubbish. So after a while, I realised that this was a good thing. But it's still an issue, I think, in terms of how many universities even have subjects in survey sampling and experimental design, for example. So I've got a long list of things that I want to talk about. Probably we'll have to skip over some of them. So I'm going to start off talking about a bit of the history and then some of the issues that are current with the sample surveys in terms of the problems that I continue to encounter in my work, our practical work. I still do consulting and research projects with outside organisations, and I've got a list of them there, and hopefully get to the end to talk about a little bit about the future. So a bit of selected history. You can argue, and I'm sure examples can be found, but basically, as we know, a sample survey, they've been around for about 100 years. And I found a nice review by Ken Brewer, which summarised some of the history. And I just want to say a few words about Ken. Ken unfortunately died earlier this year. I didn't overlap with him. He had left ABS the year before I started to do a very brave thing, which was to set up a survey research centre at ANU. And his vision was you must be running surveys to do survey research. And he was trying to get a self-funded centre. And for various reasons, it didn't quite pan out. Actually, the subject he taught on procurement and analysis of data. And many years later, I shared an office with him when we were both visiting Southampton. And in a lesson of what life can be very, very strange, Ken did a PhD later in life, supervised by Ray Chambers. And I ended up being one of the examiners, which I found quite strange. And when I used to go to international conferences and the great and good in the survey world, when they found out from Australia, the first thing they'd ask is, hi, how are Ken going? They recognised some very important work that I'll refer to slightly later that Ken did earlier in his career. And the other point I'd like to make of Ken is how committed and kind he was. As an associate editor of the journal, I used to send him a paper. He would never refuse to referee it. He would often come to the conclusion that I did, that the paper was never going to be a publishable standard, but he would still give you pages and pages of feedback to give back to the authors because he wanted to encourage them to continue their endeavours. So anyway, Ken's review highlights some things that the Norwegian statistician Kaya really was the first person to advocate what we'd now call random sampling. Didn't really get that far in convincing people in other countries or even his own country that that was a good idea. And then a UK statistician, Bowley, picked up those ideas in the early part of the 1900s. And there was an agenda over a period of about 15 years when the ISI looked at what we call random sampling as against purposive and balanced or any other sort of sampling. And then it was Neyman in 1934 and also 1936 that really started off the journey that we have now to have random sampling. And then from that time, over a period of about 20 years, there was a really large advance by practical people to develop the basics of sample survey methodology. Gallup started his poll in 1935. One of the very early books was by Frank Yates, who I looked him up the other day. I didn't realise he took over from Fisher at Rothamsted and was really an experimental designer, yet one of the very first texts in sampling was published by him in 1949. And then the influence of the US Bureau of Census through Deming and Hams Hertz of Mano came through in some very important books, Cochrane's book, 53. And then what I see is the end of that sort of generation and cohort with Kish's book in 65. So that those periods were where the fundamental theory of sample surveys and sampling methods really got established. And they were all built on the idea of random, technically probability. And I found myself having to use the word scientific a lot to convince people these are good ideas. And I always was a bit cynical that if you have to call yourself a science, then you actually are a bit insecure about being a science. But I can give you some examples, although I notice we're calling ourselves statistical science a lot lately. So anyway, so built on the idea of probability sampling, in which all population units have a known non-zero probability of selection. Probabilities don't need to be equal. And it can be useful, in fact, to vary them, to put more of the sample where there's more variation, where there's more interest, and where there's less cost. But on the other hand, don't vary the probabilities if you don't have a reason to do so. Also in this theory, there were estimates of sampling variance, and that was an important part of the development. And of course, the inference was based on the randomization distribution, which unfortunately is called design-based. And one of the points I want to make, we're always designing, even if you're a modeler, there's a design going in there. So I prefer to talk about randomization distribution rather than design-based, but I might slip into that because it's so common. Then, as I said, the US Bureau of Census is where a lot of the early development went. I think it was partly because of Naaman's influence, but also because we were in a depression, and usually a crisis is good for statistics. And so things are so bad, you have to measure them. If things are going really well, why do you need to measure them? It's when things are going bad, you need to measure them. And so I think the depression pushed a lot of this development. 1937, there was a test survey of unemployment to check some sort of voluntary register of unemployment. Interesting to use a survey probability sample to check an administrative data source. And the use of the long form on a sample within the census was introduced in 1940. And the labor force survey, which became the current population survey, was introduced in 43. The ABS history, and I've got CBSC there for the Commonwealth Bureau of Census Statistics, really goes back to Ken Foreman, who was sent to visit the USBC in the early 1950s. And from his visit, sampling evolved within the ABS, really from two ends: to replace a census or a partial collection, a census of the big guys, or to provide data when there was nothing that existed. So there's sort of two ways that the use of sampling evolved, and it evolved steadily over the 50s, 60s, and 70s. And even in the 70s, when I started, there were still people in the Bureau who had to be convinced that you could run a survey and you get these standard errors that give you some sort of indicator of the variability. But there were still people against that in the 1970s. And so there were developments even then to further use sampling. And the best thing that ever happened, of course, at ABS is when there were budget cuts that forced people to introduce sampling to save money to absorb those cuts. Particular important ones, the monthly retail survey and the quarterly labour force survey, were introduced, I think, about 1960, and the monthly labour force survey introduced in 1978. I think we were the fourth country in the world that had a national monthly labour force survey after US, Canada, and Japan. And the important thing, actually, is what ABS was doing was investing actually in the sampling frames, the business register and the development of the population survey framework. These are the two assets that the ABS had and has that enables it to run high quality surveys of businesses and of households. And the labor force survey and the establishment of the population survey framework then opened up the use of household survey methods in lots of other topics, including the National Health Survey. So that's just a little bit of history of sampling developing. And what we've got out of that is this page here of methods. I'm not going to go through each one of them, but that's really my almost shopping list. Most of the problems I work with can be solved by or tackled by one or more of these methods, usually several. And as I said in the bio, it's an art to put these things together in combination to achieve collecting the data in a cost-effective manner. And your sample design, the reason it's an art is often you don't have the information you really like to use to get the design right. You'd like to know a lot about the population structure to be able to come up with a good design, and you don't have that. So part of the art is how to cope with that issue. So that's sort of a history, a little bit of traditional probability-based sampling. At the same time, we've got to talk about the actual survey methods. How do you actually contact and obtain the data from people or units in the population? Traditionally, this was male surveys. They went out of fashion, but I think they're coming back because there's a thing called ABS, address-based sampling, and that's facilitated in America and the UK and now in Australia with the geocoded national address file. There used to be a lot of face-to-face interviewing, and we did a lot of thing about using computerized assisted personal interviewing and data collection. Obviously, that's an expensive way of collecting data. Telephones, I've seen telephones hardly used at all, and then gone through a complete development of initially listed numbers, then random digit dialing of landlines, then multi or two-phase with landlines and mobiles, and even mobile only. But, perhaps telephone surveys have had their day, something we might want to discuss. And because we're getting into the new technologies of internet and email, computer-assisted web interviewing, where's the online data, social media, and so on. And increasingly, use of mixed modes, which we always had to do, because even if we thought we were running a one-mode survey, often you had to follow up. So you'd run a mail survey of businesses, or you'd end up telephoning half of them anyway to get a response. So really, mixed modes were always there. And of course, there's lots of new technologies around. One thing that I'm aware of, and I have a slight bit of involvement, is radio audience monitoring. Was done in a very traditional dropping off diaries, but now there's a use of a wearable device that basically knows what you're listening to. So all sorts of things are happening in the survey methodology, how you contact and how you collect the data. And very much the sampling frames, the design, the variables are available on that sampling frame and the methods and the data collection, they almost fit together. They almost fit together. And if you want to read about developments, there's a list of references there. So I don't want to go on. I use the word the representative method, and I found that the concept of represent sample is not useful because I've never seen one. Because we deliberately don't use representative samples. We deliberately vary the selection probabilities for very good reasons. So our sample doesn't look like the population. Now we bang it into shape later to make it look so. So in fact, the idea of a representative sample is not useful. And I have a lot of clients, they say, I want a representative sample. I say, how do you think you're going to get it? Say, we're going to advertise on Facebook. As long as we get the ASX distribution right, we'll be fine. So I actually don't use the word representative sample, and that's why I've gone to this thing of trying to talk about scientific sampling. Sometimes you actually want a heterogeneous sample, perhaps even more heterogeneous than the population for good reasons. You want more old men, more young kids, more people of a certain sort. And it's an interesting debate or connection with the people who do random controls trials, who often try and make their samples very homogeneous to get rid of a lot of variability. So when they look at the treatment versus control, the intrinsic variation is low, but it affects the external generalizability. And we're seeing that in quite a few things just at the moment. And often the representative sample is essentially taken in terms of households anyway, that you've got the age sets and geography and perhaps education distribution right. So I don't like to use the word representative sample. I don't mind samples that produce unbiased estimates. That's a good thing. So probability sampling, I've already defined it, and I'm going to introduce a bit of notation that Alan will recognize. The idea is that, well, okay, we have a population U, and we basically have a vector of indicators of sample membership. And in abstract, we have these design variables that are available, hopefully, on the sampling frame. Could be age and sex, could be geography, could be size of the school, or something like that. And what we want to do is we give each unit a known and non-zero probability of selection, and we certainly try to avoid volunteer or convenient selection. And as I say to some of my clients, this sort of probability sampling takes you where you don't want to go, but you need to go. It makes you select a household that has a rusty old car in the front garden, and you don't really want to go there, but you've selected that household. Let's go into that household. And also the one that is, or it's out way out in the rural areas, and you don't really want to spend the money to go out there. Basic idea is that the probabilities of selection are pi, and these are in theory all known and non-zero. And in fact, the joint probability of selection determine the randomization variance. And you can put costs into the design. Well, the point that Rob and I try and always show is costs enter in the square root, usually, if you have a linear cost function. So that's the general theory, traditional theory of probability sampling. Ignorable sampling is, I think, a very important concept that has different names, comes up in different places, but I think is very fundamental. And the idea is really, let's suppose we have a variable of interest Y, some explanatory variables X, and we still have our design variables that we've used that have influenced the sample design. And the idea of ignorability is that, and this notation here is convenient. It says distribution of. So we're now assuming some sort of distribution. And the idea of ignorability is that the distribution of the sample indicators conditional on the response variable and what else we observe doesn't depend on the response variable. And that leads to all sorts of conclusions about what you can do with your analysis and modeling. Now, probability sampling would use, because it depends only, selection probabilities only depend on these auxiliary variables Z, usually before non-response, which I'll get onto in a second, implies ignorability, but not the other way around. You can have designs that are very not probability. I might take the smallest and the largest values, for example. And that therefore allows purposive selection and zero chances of selection. But it doesn't allow for volunteer or convenient sampling or self-selection. And also doesn't necessarily mean that every parameter is identified. Sometimes people miss that. You can have the largest and the smallest, but if I'm trying to put a polynomial, I can't estimate every parameter. And so this is a very strong element, idea. And then it tells you that the likelihood can be based on what you observe, but doesn't depend on the way you got the sample, or it depends on the characteristics of the sample in terms of the Zs there. And then last set of or type of sampling is informative or non-ignorable, where whether or not you're in the sample does depend on things that you'd like to know, like the values of unobserved units. It always sounds very esoteric, but I actually have a little example. If you go to Melbourne Airport, those you've been through, there's quite a well-controlled queuing system for cabs, right? And usually, 9 times out of 10, there's no problem. You get off your plane, you walk into the queue, a few minutes and you're done. Every now and then, for one reason or other, the queue blows out. You're there for 20 minutes. And one time this happened to me, I was facing this concrete pillar and it said, if you have any comments on your service here today, please email or so this number. And I only saw that when the queue was really bad. So that's informative selection, because if I'm looking at satisfaction with this queuing system, you only get response for people who actually even saw this sign, which you normally whiz past if it's going well. So that's non-ignorable. What you should try and do is actually still try and work out what this function is, how the selection probabilities depend on Y. Sometimes that's possible, but usually it's not. And then you're left with the true likelihood is based on the distribution of what you observed. So I'll come back to that because I think this distinction between probability sampling and ignorable is actually a fundamental one that we need to take into account a lot more. Okay, so there's been a lot of heat over the decades. I think the heat's gone out a little bit, but I think it's still worth getting our heads straight about differences in the approaches to design, estimation, analysis. And we need to distinguish between the design, i.e. the sampling method, which could include ignorable ones and non-ignorable and purposive, targets of inference and method of inference. And how the data is to be or has been obtained is vital. And there's a little bit, I think, a tension in between statisticians who work as designers and those who work as analysts. But your design, when you come up with design, you really need to know what's going to be done with the data way at the end. And I find clients very frustrated. I say, what are you going to do with it afterwards? Well, worry about that once we've collected it. No, I need to know now what you want to do with the data at the end. But also, once the data has been collected, the analyst needs to know how it was collected. Okay, and if you ignore important parts of the way it was collected, you're going to come up with bad analyses. So there's a distinction between descriptive or enumerative things, which are functions of the actual population values, typically means, totals, proportions, ratios, and differences. Okay, fairly simple statistics, and a lot of what ABS produces, for example, and a lot of other surveys, the basic output is the proportion of people, the number of people in a certain characteristic. But there's then the analytical, and you can think about this as the parameter of a model, unhelpfully sometimes called a superpopulation model. Again, it's the survey statistician using a terminology that confuses and alienates them from the rest of statistics, in my view. It's just a model for the population values. And there's a slight distinction between what's called the census parameter, which is if I had all the finite population values and I did my analysis, what would I get? Now, the difference between these two things is often not of importance. Occasionally it is. And then there might be also interest in prediction, using your analysis to predict for unobserved units or future observations. So those are the different targets of inference. Then the method of inference is the randomization-based. So I've already talked about it. It says, okay, let's evaluate things in terms of the distribution that we get of this estimator over all the different samples we could have got. Model-assisted came in to formalize the ideas of trying to understand the population structure, both in design and estimation. But in the end, the inference is randomization-based. And then there's the model-based, also called model-dependent or prediction, where we really put our value in looking at models. And you can't argue about being likelihood or Bayesian, but that's actually not a big thing from my point of view. So we have the method of inference, we have the target of inference, the method of inference, and then the design and the sampling approach. And I've already talked about probability sampling, ignorable, informative. And this was my attempt to summarize that, where I've got the inference approach and in brackets the design. So the inference approach is like randomization is the basis of how you analyze the data after you've got it, but it's pretty well tied to the idea of probability sampling. Whereas I think model-based in practice is tied to ignorable sampling, although you can have situations where you can try and model a non-ignorability. But we have these two columns here in terms of, are we just interested in the totals of population totals of various variables or simple functions of them? And then you've got different ways of coming up with your estimator and also your design, because in the randomization approach, we're trying to minimize the variance over repeated samples, whereas in the model-based approach, we're trying to minimize the essentially mean square error of predictions based on the model. But then if we go over to analytical targets, things slightly change. There's the idea of pseudo-maximum likelihood, which is really a way, weighted version of the estimating equations you'd use with likelihood. And just recently, Robert and I have been looking at how to minimize the how to come up with designs that minimize the variance of a pseudo likelihood estimator. And the work that is in the book that Ray, Alan, and Sujing and I work on looks at the completely likelihood based, which is really looking at what's the distribution, how do we do analysis based on our sample values and our population information. And I don't think there's been a systematic attempt to look at how you come up with designs using that criterion. So this is just trying to make the different situations. So really, most traditional sample designs are sort of, and methods are sort of here, or perhaps model assisted, where we try and use modeling a little bit to simplify. Some things drop out nicely, and it also enables us to utilize simple data. We reduce the number of parameters we have to assume we know to come up with a design. And but the problem about the approach that's in the book that we wrote is that the full information maximum likelihood really does start to get you to start to model the y, X's and the Y's. In most statistical analyses, we model Y given X, possibly Y given X and Z. But once we get into this full information maximum likelihood, we have to start having models for the X's and the Z's. And if you look at the book, it gives us a fair bit of sweat there. I'll just skip a few things there. But one thing I wanted to say was that develop a more complex sampling methods beyond simple random sampling, which is what most people think of as random sampling. So I tend not to even use random sampling, because people assume you mean equal probability or possibly even simple random. And most, I very rarely use that. I mean, the designs I use are more complex for good logistical cost reasons and to get good efficiency. And so, so we get these more complex methods because of the practicality of trying to do good surveys. And they preceded the developments of modeling beyond independent and identically distributed assumptions by decades. So over the last 30 plus years, we've done a lot to handle models that don't assume IID. And so we got multi-level modeling that sort of really came into its fore probably in the 80s. Yet multi-stage sampling was developed in the late 30s. So that's an interesting thing about the development and surveys in parallel with modeling analysis. And then when you bring the two together, which is what's considered in the two volumes, Skinner, Holton-Smith, and Chambers and Skinner, is what we now know as the analysis of complex survey data. If you have a complex design, but the population is IID, it doesn't matter that it was complex to design. Or if you have simple random sampling and you have a complex model, it doesn't matter. It's the two complexities together that lead to this very interesting area, which has been really tackled quite thoroughly in the last 30 years. So another thing that I, actually, as I was reading up for this talk, was how much as statisticians, we confuse ourselves and we confuse our clients in our use of randomness. We magically transform things to be random. And so to me, there's the sample generation, which is variability and inclusion. Because one of my hobbies is, little aside, I found that people hate statisticians. Why? Because we're the people who can say, it's not good enough what you've done. Your sample size is too small. And I'm going to confuse you by discussing randomness in four ways. So I think we should be using variability and uncertainty where we can still talk about errors. If there's a reporting error, that's an error. But if it's an interview of variance, that's a reporting variability. So anyway, sample generation is variability and inclusion, and that could be the selection probabilities, which in a probability sample are explicit and known. They always exist, these selection probabilities, but in general we don't know what they are, and they could even be zero. But there are selection probabilities and there are response probabilities. So one of the big problems in any survey is getting response, and that's also, we can conceive of it as a probabilistic process. Then there's the observation generation, which is the variability in the observation, which includes measurement error. but also the intrinsic, what a lot of statisticians would think of random variation and randomness, which is the randomness in your model, right? That's to do with really generating the observations. And then we turn around and say, once we've got, and we do a little magical trick, sometimes a parameter is fixed, and then when it's convenient to it, it becomes a bit random, right? This is a trick that we do all the time without often a lot of explanation. Reduces the number of parameters, which is a good thing. So then once we've collected the data, we do a thing called inference, and we use randomness and probability in a different way. And it's really about uncertainty. And so statistical inference about parameters, uncertainty about parameters in the sort of prior posterior sense in Bayesian analysis, and uncertainty in the predictions of unobserved or future units. And so those are all, to me, reasonably different uses of randomness and probability. And as I've got my little homily there, let's stop using the word error. Oh, it's too late, I know. But let's stop using word error unless it's a bias. So let's go back to models. I wanted to highlight the local connections, but also the precedent. You know, Brewer 63, very early paper using models to understand sampling and estimation, then Ken Foreman, there's a 71 paper, then Brewer and Meller in 73, and a nice paper that gets a bit lost in the proceedings of the ISI with Ken Brewer, Foreman, Bob Meller and Dennis Truen. And that was all coming out of here, ABS. It's really good work. Doesn't necessarily get a lot of prominence now, but we should never forget the early foundational stuff that was done at that time. And it was all about formulating what we all do as survey designers is trying to get an understanding of a population structure through modeling analysis to then use in our design and perhaps estimation. And that motivates things like generalized regression estimation. And non-response adjustment, however you do it, there's a model there. Small area and domain estimation, it goes back. Noel Purcell, who was at ABS, did some work earlier there with Leslie Kish. And so in practice, despite the theoretical niceness of the randomization, well, or not, randomization theory, you've got to confront the fact you have random processes in terms of non-response. And even an assumption that within post-strata, the respondents and non-respondents are the same on average is a model, because an assumption is a model. So models basically have to be used anyway. There's just some list here of the advantages and disadvantages of sample surveys. They have some good, they're large and expensive and can be slow, not always, you can run them fast. You do need a good sampling frame. And I noted earlier on the investment ABS puts in to getting good frames. You control the construct. That's why I actually don't think surveys will disappear entirely, because if you want a survey about a certain aspect of mental health, you want to control the construct that you collect data about. And that control or form data, I think, is important. It provides data on individuals. That can be good, because if you use aggregate data analysis, you've got the potential of the ecological fallacy. On the other hand, if you look at individuals out of context, perhaps you're missing something, but you can solve that by contextual variables and deliberately using cluster sampling, even if it wasn't cost effective, but because you want to get some idea of the within cluster correlations. They're observational. If you're a causal analysis person, you're only looking at associations, but they can represent many groups in the population. So if the sample size is big enough, they can give a lot of external validity, and you can look at subgroups. On the other hand, sooner or later, your sample size becomes too small, and so they have difficulty with small or rare groups or events. Even if it's an interviewer, but particularly if it's self-reporting, there'll be reporting and measurement error, and non-contacts and refusals are a ubiquitous problem. Complex designs are used, and so on. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about non-response and coverage, because you know, non-response, which is non-contact and non-cooperation. And often when someone, well, I've looked, for this talk again, I looked at some surveys. Very hard to find out the response rate of a survey. You go to the technical documentation, very hard. And even then you've got to be careful, could be the cooperation rate. Of those that we contacted, 60% cooperated. We only contacted 40% of those that we selected, right? So there is a bit of a, there are standards to this, but if you go to, on the web anyway, you try and find a discussion of a survey's response rate and its cooperation rate. You can put this in because we can conceive of the response having a propensity. Now, we're not going to use the word probability, propensity. We can set up an indicator about response in the similar way that we did for sample inclusion. And the problem is that may depend on, we would hope that it would depend on some measurable quantities, but in general, it's unknown and it may be zero. So in general, the distribution of the response indicator is informative. It tells you the people who respond are responding because of some of the variables you're interested in. And so what we try and do is model that or conjure up ignorability. And what I mean by conjuring up, well, these are all conditional arguments. So if you can find variables that make the response mechanism close to ignorable, then you are going to make some progress. I'll come back to that. So in terms of frames, you have a similar thing that frames are always got inadequacies. And what we can think of, And so we've got frames, and often what we try and do is actually have multiple frames that together, or two frames that together give us better coverage. And I'll come back to that later because I think a lot of the problems that we're trying to tackle these days really can be formulated in terms of two sources or frames and indicator variables for membership of those frames, AI and BI, which sort of we can model or think about in the same way we do selection probabilities and response probabilities. And then you've got missing data and measurement error. Actually, at this point, you know, this reminds me, years ago, a researcher from England came here, this is a long time ago, and the BBC were having little 10-minute films on there because it was just when the British were starting to go to France on holiday. And so the BBC, which is partly public service broadcaster, said, let's do little stories about what will be involved in going to France. Get your passport, buy your ticket, you know, learn a bit of French, how do you drive a car on a ferry, and just to educate people. And what they found afterwards is once you made it clear to people what was involved to going to France, very few wanted to. And it's about this point in this talk, I think the same. You should have now come to the conclusion. The last thing you want to do is have any involvement with a sample survey, given all the problems that I've just... And the good news is there are solutions or potential solutions to all of these, but they are hard work. One thing I've come across is that a common opinion is that biases due to non-response and coverage are less for estimates of association than for, say, means. Now, mathematically, this doesn't have to be true, but it turns out that it might be. And there's a study that I referred to there I was involved in. We compared the 45 and up survey, which had an 18% response rate, with the New South Wales Population Health Survey, which had a 60% response rate. And we looked at various odds ratios. And we only adjusted for age, sex, and region, and then looked at the association between smoking and high blood pressure. And in general, the odds ratio, substantively, were very, very similar. So, and that is now my most highly cited paper. So for you academics, write a paper that gives permission to people to do something that they really want to do anyway, and then you'll get a lot of citations. So, but mathematically, there might be a reason that one way of thinking about non-response bias is a correlation between this response probability and the variable of interest. But if you go into analysis, for example, using likelihood, then essentially you can show that the bias due to non-response is the correlation between the response propensity and the score, which is essentially a residual. And I think that's a way also of thinking of coverage error. It's the correlation between the probability of being in the sampling frame or the big data set and how it's correlated with the score function if you're doing likelihood analysis would be a key factor. And just recently, I was looking again for this talk, what's the sort of things I've done over the last little while? A lot of times I've actually been asked to do non-response adjustments, often for things that started out in theory as a census. So the aged care workforce census, for example. And what you end up doing is a modelling process. You're trying to model that thigh-eye, that response probability. And that's a lot of my practical consulting work recently has been in that area. Once you've done a bit of modelling to understand those factors that you can measure and how they influence response, then you can discuss the methods, inverse or propensity, using the inverse of the propensity score, creating weighting cells or some sort of regression estimation. I'm building up to a theme here, I think. So I've talked about the auxiliary variables. These are things on the population frame that can be used to collect your sample and may be related to the phenomenon of interest. You can't forget about them even in a modelling approach. Typically, we'd have an explanatory variable X. I actually think this is a distinction that used to be made, but it seems to have disappeared between the explanatory variables you put in the model because you're interested in them and covariates you put in the model that you're not interested in, but you know you have to have them. And why is that important? Because some of the methods that handle things like non-probability samples are really about appropriate finding of covariates. They're covariates in that they're useful. They're not auxiliary variables because we don't know them for every unit in the population, but they might help us combine, for example, a probability sample and non-probability sample. So I introduced them. And these variables, these auxiliary variables, these explanatory variables, and these covariates really are, it's getting those variables that gets you closer to ignorability of the sample selection, if it's a non-random sample, or coverage, or response probability. And so that's what I'm saying there. It's once you've got the idea of those, and therefore, like people worry about small error estimation. A lot of papers are about what to do with the random error term in small area estimation, which use regression models with area level random effects. If you don't get the regression part of the model reasonably right, doesn't matter how clever you are with the random error, the model based error, the area error. And so there should be, and some papers make that clear, but some don't. But finding those covariates is the key. And a point that is important to come up in a minute, that the data generating process does matter. In a very simple one, if you've got a variable y, an alpha I is whether or not you're on the data set, then the distribution of y, given that you're on the data set, can be shown immediately to be the distribution of y with a modification, this ratio here, which is essentially the basis of something like it. Now, if whether or not you're on the data set doesn't depend on y, this becomes one. But in general, that's not the case. My informative thing, you know, the notice about the satisfaction with the taxi queue. I'm going to move quickly. The data quality is, survey statisticians have developed a lot of understanding and frameworks for data quality. Even when I started here at the ABS, the focus was on sampling error. That was what was being introduced by replacing a complete collection by sampling. So sampling error. And after a while, people said, yeah, but there's all these other things, which at first we call non-sampling errors. And then later on, the total survey error, total survey quality. The quality has a lot more dimensions than just the sampling error, which we tended to focus on because you do have measures of it and you know how to reduce it by better estimation and larger sample sizes and better designs. And there's a nice framework, total survey quality framework, which is listed there, which goes through all the different errors, or more generally, and Stats Canada and ABS have your data quality framework, which applies not just to survey data, but to the other data sources, relevance, accuracy, timeliness, accessibility, interpretability, and coherence. And that's taken a while to get those views from, say, what I was encountering when I started the ABS, just focusing on sampling variance. Okay, now we'll come to, so that's a bit of the past, a bit of what's happened, all the things that you have to think about if you're a sample survey guy. So what are the challenges and opportunities? Well, as I said, it's disappointing how much sample surveys are seen as separate from the rest of statistical science. And I'm guilty of this. So we, at Wollongong, we do have a subject, half sample surveys and half experimental design. But again, it seems a bit dissociated from other subjects. And I can see other universities don't even have such subjects. And so how do we get the importance of design, and it's not just sample surveys, but you know, just teaching people about ignorability, epidemiologists, for example, would be really important. And so how do we get people to understand the fundamental role of data generation and data quality? I actually am quite hopeful. I've got a couple of projects on the go to use this geocoded national address file and use mail surveys and then ask people to go to the web, for example. I think that's a methodology that's going to come because that address file hasn't been around that long. It is used, for example, in the Australian electoral study, gets a response rate of 42%. Low response rates. I've been hearing people complain about low response rates for about 35 years. It is hard, but there is research on motivating cooperation. You can do things better or worse. And what I tend to do is read what Dillman, Krosnick, Cannell, or Groves, people like that, will say about this. There is a whole literature about motivating people to cooperate, although it changes. Who answers their landline now? Who answers their phone now? Whereas 5 years ago, people would answer their phone. So the problem is that research becomes dated in many ways because the change in communication and technology, our interaction with it, they're changing as well. And this is a real challenge. But we've got to contact people, that's a problem. But having contacted them, or a business, or an aged care provider, or a school, how do we motivate them to respond? It's not just about incentives and other things. And again, I'm working on some projects and I'm really trying to tell them we have to think about how we're going to get people to respond. And you've got to allow cost and time in the budget for follow-up. I find people, when I work with other clients, they don't want to put enough time into development and they don't want to budget for follow-up, both in time and money. These are the two things that I try and push. And as I said before, just finding out what response rate are is difficult. And one of the challenges is that you've got to demonstrate the value of quality, which costs. Non-probability samples are a big thing. A lot of social research is moving that way. The survey community over the last 10 years have really thought about this a lot. They're very cheap, quick and convenient. Methods are often not clear. Questions about coverage, they can essentially be a volunteer survey. Darren Penne and his group have actually done some comparisons with probability samples, with non-probability samples. But it's a good question, where are they cost-effective? Going back to my analytical thing, perhaps if I'm really interested in associations, perhaps I can be a little bit more relaxed about non-probability samples. But some people are building up probability-based panels. Life in Australia, again, done by the Social Research Centre in Melbourne. And the TV ratings basically are based on a probability sample recruited. Although I noticed that they're now getting streaming data from a thing called VOS, so every time you stream something, that's being recorded. And there's a lot of work on combining with the probability samples, and you use variables in common to try and calibrate the online sample to the probability sample. And you need more than demographics, age, sex, marital status, education doesn't fix it. There's behavioural thing, early adopter status, and there's this project I've been involved in, which Australian values and attitudes on AI, where we've done that. We've got a probability sample through Life in Australia of about 2,400, collected some basic information, including behavioural things about use of technology, and then we got an online panel of 2,000 to ask about attitudes to AI. And that was a very cost-effective way. And the sample of 2,000 actually is enough to start breaking things down about whether you've got an IT background or not. We're still evaluating that. Opinion polls, I've got good advertisement for sample surveys, question mark. Often they are run to demonstrate how good your survey methods are, but there have been problems in the UK, US and Australia, which have been reviewed. And the pandemic, the survey community was found that it adapted very quickly. A lot of new collections were put in. They adapted their collection methods to assess opinions and effectiveness, including ABS, did quite a lot. But little use directly of sample surveys to measure the incidence and prevalence of COVID. Nick Fisher and Dennis Truen lobbied for that. So did I and Noel Cressy. Huge resistance. And the best example I can find where they've actually run a general community survey to estimate prevalence of COVID is in the UK. The fact is we don't know how many people have COVID at any given point. We know a lower limit, which is the number of people who've been tested and positive. So I just wanted to go on, just the last one is data science, big data and so on. This, in a way, the online panel, the non-probability sample combined with probability sample thinking can be transferred to the idea of big data. We've always had admin data. Epidemiologists and health researchers have always referred to routinely collected data, now found data or big data. What's big changes over time, but there's many types and sources, sensors, monitors, satellites, and so on. Whenever you look about data science and big data, they talk about the five Vs: volume, velocity, variety, variability, and value. But there is a cost in time and effort to produce big data. You've got to identify the data sources. You've got, which may be multiple, generate, extract, combine, transform, load. You've still got to check and clean the data, and you've also perhaps got to do some data language and data fusion. And to me, we should be talking about control, controlling the concepts, including the unit that we're collecting the data about. Coverage, selection, coherence, and consistency. To me, these are important attributes. All the data quality issues that we're used to apply, Bimer and his colleagues took the total quality survey framework and with very little modification can apply it to big data. And I think in the research realm, reproducibility and repeatability issues are becoming more and more prominent. So how does big data shape up there? What worries me about big data is I have data today that shows me this association, and tomorrow I don't see it in the data set. So what I think of as ephemeral results. There is direct use of sampling in big data, training data sets for machine learning, for example. Even with high performance computing, you might subset your data just for computational feasibility. Also, you might have to do a lot of data cleaning. So why not do that on a sample rather than the whole lot? And also replication variance methods are a sort of a sampling approach. Not all sample sizes are the same. We need to recognize that. We all know this, the bias due to informative does not disappear as the sample sets bigger. And we need to apply that informative sampling framework in our thinking. And also, if the data is very highly correlated, I mean, if I measure the temperature every second of the day, I get a huge data set, but I'm not sure what the information content is given the correlation. So one way to tackle that is to think of an effective sample size that puts the bias in and the correlation to say what would a random sample, what size random sample would give me the same mean square error. There are uses, I think, with big data in particular. Well, there are lots of uses of big data, particularly in rare groups and events. And what we're seeing is really a development of methods of the flavour that I've already discussed, that are about, we've got a probability sample from some population A, that might be our sample A, and then from our big data set, we may have a sample or we may have all of them, and that's our information. And so we want to integrate, we want to actually use that information, and that's where I think the sort of framework we need to come into that is to formulate in terms of the response variable, the explanatory variable, the covariates, the auxiliary variables, and the indicators of membership of the two sources and their intersection. There are different things you can do depending whether or not you know someone has been tested for COVID and is in your sample, where you test them again reliably. So, and there are different cases that you can consider, but the methods are there. If you've got the covariates, and that's the if, then the methods of propensity scoring and weighting, calibration methods and imputation are there. So we have the tools if we have the data to some extent. I think there are issues with machine learning with complex data structures. It's analogous to the complex survey analysis thing. You know, there's a lot of structure in big data. Is it always recognized, clustering and other things, and all the data quality issues arise as well. And so I just wanted to finish up by actually showing that the Wollongong group, because Su Ming is honorary professor at the University of Wollongong. When I looked at this, I found that Jay Kim and Su Ming had been doing a lot of work on this. And good luck to them. I think this is a very important way of tackling these important issues of essentially how do we make use of big data, possibly in combination with sample surveys.